So I don't think it will come as a surprise to anyone in the room that socioeconomic status matters to child development. It's across all developmental areas. So I was particularly interested in language development. So we know from previous research that children's language abilities diverge before school and the gap tends to keep increasing over time. We know from fairly recent research that these differences are already evident within the second year of life. And we know that early language environment plays a role. But what we don't really understand yet is just how early these differences start and how early they matter. There's very little evidence so far. Most of the research that's been carried out is focused on children in the second year and beyond, once they're already speaking some quiet words. And we don't really have a good understanding of why these differences come about and why it might be that higher SES parents may talk more to their children than lower SES parents. So there is still a lot to be answered in this area of research. So, but when we talk about SES, we're not just talking about one thing. It's multifaceted. So if we think of it in terms of capital, then it involves different types of capital. So, but when it comes to the early cognitive environment that babies are developing in, maternal education seems to stand out as a particularly important factor. It's been linked to child language in a wealth of research over the last decades, and it seems that outside of extreme poverty, it may be the SES factor that's the most relevant to child language development. It's shown in cultures across the world, and it has also been shown to be a stronger predictor than income and paternal education. So this is what I zoomed in on. And the aim of the study was to investigate how maternal education relates to children's spoken vocabulary across 12 months, and I carried out a longitudinal investigation. So I'll just give you a little bit of an overview of the broader study, but I won't speak about all of it today. So we identified the potential pathways through which this association might be coming about. So the main one that we focused on was early language experience, but I also collected a lot of data trying to sort of dig into these social factors to get an understanding of why it might be that these differences come about. I won't speak about the social factors today, but if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them afterwards. So the project, as I said, was longitudinal. The way we approached it was to look at how maternal education related to early language experience, and then how maternal education and early language experience then related to later vocabulary development. Just to give you a little picture of the sorts of things that we did look at in the wider investigation, we also looked at mothers' knowledge of child development, how competent they felt as parents, whether they were feeling well socially supported, how their morale was, their depression, and I also did a measure of the mother's cognitive ability to see how that fit into the picture as well. So, but what I'll be talking about today is the top two. So we used Lena to quantify how much talk was going on at home, and we used the Auslan, which Marina has very nicely introduced, so I don't need to go into that. We looked at language input at two ages and vocabulary at two ages. So it was a home-based study. I hit the streets of Sydney to go and visit 50 families across the space of a year. So I visited each family three times. At the first two visits, I got them to use the Lena to measure the language experience. So is anyone familiar or not familiar with Lena? If you're not familiar with Lena, so it's a little recorder that just is worn on a vest on the child for the day as they just go about their day. Lena records everything in the environment, and then it provides estimates of a number of things, but I used the three sort of main measures that Lena produces, which is the number of words being spoken near and to the child, and the number of conversational interactions they're being involved in every day, so little back and forth interactions with adults, and how much the children are vocalising themselves. So Lena gives us like a 12-hour projection of those estimates of each of those counts. So I use Lena at, oh, go back
for that. At between 6 and 9 months, at 12 to 15 months, and then they have you at 12 to 15 months and 19 months. Again, if you're not familiar with Lena, this is sort of what it looks like if you want to pull out a report. These reports can be given back to parents to give them some feedback about just how much is being spoken at home, and you know when the really talkative times are at home. So you can look at it as like a daily average, an hourly average, or even break it down into 5 minute segments. So I was working with a daily average. Again, we used the OSI to measure vocabulary. So I was only interested in expressive vocabulary. I didn't measure receptive vocabulary in this study. And the inference came from Greater Western Sydney. As Marina was saying, that a lot of the norms for the OSI were based on middle and high SES parents. So I was really keen to get parents from low SES backgrounds, and we found that that was a bit more challenging than I first thought it might be. So I found that I really needed to go out to community groups and mothers groups and libraries and Facebook and just find these mothers who don't necessarily engage with our research in the lab typically. So there were 50 families in the study. Miraculously, they all stayed with me throughout. And I divided infants into two maternal education groups on whether mothers had or hadn't completed a university degree. So we drew that as the dividing line. It's probably a little bit boring. We balanced age across the groups, and maternal age was very similar across the groups. So there were no sort of really big differences within the groups other than education level. So I posed two questions. So the first thing we're interested in is how much are parents talking to the babies in relation to maternal education? And how does the quantity of talk then relate to children's spoken vocabulary as they were getting older? Based on previous literature, we expected that higher levels of maternal education would relate to more parental talk in the earlier months, and that this in turn would relate to larger child vocabulary in the later months. So, the first thing that we looked up was how much was being spoken to the infants. So here we have the number of words spoken on average in a day, which ranged from around 5,000 to 30,000 between different families. And we found that mothers with university educations spoke on average around 4,000 more words a day to their infants between 6 and 9 months. And at 12 to 15 months, this was still around about 3,000 words per day more. So then we looked at how much conversational interaction was going on between parents and children. And we found that at 6 to 9 months, so the range here was from around 100 to around 900 word interactions per day. And again, we found that mothers with university educations were engaging in around 110 more conversational interactions with their infants already at 6 to 9 months, and this had increased to around 126 more by 12 to 15 months. So this, we expect that word count should sort of remain fairly stable over time, parents are talkative or not talkative, but this was the thing that was of particular interest for me, because this is how much they're actually engaging with the babies. And already across that time, this gap was starting to increase. But what it didn't seem to be driven by was differences in how much the infants themselves were vocalising. There was no significant difference between the groups and how much the babies were vocalising at either age. So it suggests that it's about parent responsiveness that's driving these maternal education differences. So that was question one, how does maternal education relate to early experience? And then we moved on to how does that then relate to child vocabulary? So the first thing we did was look at the OSI scores based on our two maternal education groups. We had expected that we may not see a difference earlier on, but based on the previous literature, that by around 19 months we should start to see some difference. Surprisingly, we didn't. The averages for the two groups were not significantly different.
And this did surprise us, so we had looked at, you know, there's a lot of variation within the groups. So we dug down a little bit deeper and we looked at a vocabulary a little bit differently and split our groups into four education groups, because we had mothers from, you know, a year 9 education to postgraduate degree. So we then split them into a less than high school group, a high school group, a bachelor degree group and a postgraduate degree group to see what the data looked like there. So at 12 to 15 months, you can see that this lowest education group really starts to stand out compared to the others. So we didn't do comparisons between all the group, but we used this lowest education group as a reference group and we compared the other groups to them. And we found that there were significant differences between the two lower groups and significant differences between the less than high school group and the postgrad degree group. At 19 months, when we did the same thing, we didn't actually see the same differences. We'll come back to that in a minute, because there are some things going on in our sample that might help to explain it. So this was maternal education in relation to vocabulary. So then the next step was to look at how early language experience related to later vocabulary. So we then conducted lagged correlations. So we wanted to look at the relationship between the language experience at one point and vocabulary around 6 months later. So down here on the x-axis, you have the adult word count at 6 to 9 months, and here we've got children's scores on the vocabulary at 12 to 15 months. And we found that adult word count was not a significant predictor of later vocabulary at 12 to 15 months. Oh, sorry, that's cut off up there. And so then we looked at vocabulary at 19 months and how well that was predicted by adult word count at 12 to 15 months. And we found again that adult word count was not a significant predictor of vocabulary. So then we looked at conversational turns, which is our other measure that was related to maternal education. And we found that at 12 to 15 months, the number of back and forth interactions infants were having at 6 to 9 months was a significant predictor of vocabulary at 12 to 15 months. The more interaction they were getting early on, the more words they knew 6 months later. And then we found when we looked at it at 19 months, that conversational interaction at 12 to 15 months accounted for quite a lot of the variation in children's vocabulary size at 19 months. And if you're like a lot of people that I've talked to this about at this point, you might be asking, but couldn't this just be explained by earlier vocabulary? The infants who had bigger vocabulary at 12 to 15 months would just be the ones who have a bigger vocabulary at 19 months. So the answer to that is no. When we looked at the prediction of earlier vocabulary, it was naturally a significant predictor, but when we added into our regression model the number of conversational interactions at the same age, this still added to the model and added a significant proportion of the variance explained in 19-month vocabulary. So when you consider the two together, then you're accounting for around about 50% of the variance in children's vocabulary. I'll probably just looked at, you know, whether the conversational interaction was actually mediating any relationships between maternal education and vocabulary. The short answer was that at 12 to 15 months, it was partially, but at 19 months, we didn't see the relationship between maternal education and vocab. It all seemed to be about the conversational interaction at that age. And I'll just take a minute and just step back to the result where we didn't sort of find this difference at 19 months that we really expected to see. So this plot shows infant scores on the OSI at 19 months divided into our four education groups. And as you can see up here, when we look at the males and females in the very highest education group, there's quite a divide between them at that point. So I think that this sort of could help to explain why we didn't perhaps see that difference. Maureen was talking about the importance of sort of adding some of this data into the OSI models. And we did find that overall, the infants in our study sat below the OSI norms across the board. And
they did come from areas of Sydney that were generally low SES. We didn't have any parents from really high income areas. They did tend to be from the lower income areas of Western Sydney. So this is something that we'll sort of talk about and work on, because they, across the board, did seem to be lagging behind. So in summary, when we looked at maternal education differences in language measures, we found it in the first year and early in the second year, with the university education being the dividing line. When we looked at the conversation term counts, this was present as early as 6 to 9 months and continued 6 months later. Didn't appear to be driven by the infant vocalisation. With the OSI, we saw the vocabulary differences at 12 to 15 months only when we pulled the data apart and looked at these more narrow educational strata. And when it came to predictive vocabulary, conversational term count, not adult word count, seemed to be the important factor. And there just seemed to be some gender differences within our sample in the second year. So in terms of how early, very early. It's important early, and it shows up early. And based on the fact that our lowest education grant seemed to sit fairly consistently right down the bottom, tells us that when we're looking at these differences in maternal education, we need to really pay attention to these particularly low levels of education, these groups. And that it seems to be the verbal interaction, not just the number of words babies are hearing, that's the important factor for early experience feeding into vocabulary. So from these results, we see that social interaction is really important for babies very early on in life. And our results suggest some possible avenues for early intervention strategies, simple early intervention strategies, that parents do have the power to help in simple ways that don't involve expensive resources or particularly heavy demands on their time. We're talking about simple things like just chatting with the babies while they're going about their daily activities and noticing that their babies are trying to communicate and responding to that. And that when we're looking at interventions, that it could be that these parents with the lowest levels of education might need some extra support because they do seem to be sort of really lagging behind. And that's all. Thank you.